My dear friends in Christ, I welcome each and every one of us to this first meeting with intercessors for the year, and we are going to start this meeting with the scripture in Leviticus chapter 6, verse 8 to 13. I repeat, the book of Leviticus, chapter number 6, verse 8 to 13. And I'm reading from the Good News Translation. The Lord commanded Moses to give Aaron and his sons the following regulations for burnt offerings. A burnt offering is to be left on the altar all night long, and the fire is to be kept burning. Then the priest, wearing his linen robe and the linen shirt, shall remove the greasy ashes left on the altar and put them at the side of the altar. Then he shall change his clothes and take the ashes outside the camp to a ritually clean place. The fire on the altar must be kept burning and never be allowed to go out. Every morning, the priest shall put firewood on it, arrange the burnt offering on it, and burn the fat of the fellowship offering. The fire must always be kept burning on the altar and never allowed to go out. And this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to you, O Lord. My dear friends in Christ, in the book of Leviticus, we see a lot of instructions that God gave to the priestly people. And in chapter 6, we see an instruction that God gave concerning sacrifice, about how to make the burnt offering, how to make sacrifice burned whole. And God gave instructions to Moses to tell Aaron on what to do at the altar of God. The altar of God is a place of prayer. The altar of God is a place of prayer. Please take note of that. Every temple must have an altar. Whether an evil altar or a good altar, there must be an altar. It is the altar that empowers the temple. For those who are of the kingdom of God, the altar of the temple is the altar of Jesus. Altar that is empowered by the Holy Spirit. And that is the altar of the God of Moses and the God of Aaron. And God told Moses to tell Aaron that at that altar, you must always put it on fire. There must always be fire burning at the altar. All right? And he told them that in order to make sure the fire is burning day and night, you must provide wood to replace the burnt out wood. So the summary is that at the altar, fire must be kept burning. God says, in other words, I cannot tolerate my altar to be out of fire. Mm. That is what we have gathered today, to listen to God and to receive the fire of God in our own altar. Remember that our body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. And just like I said earlier on, that every temple must have an altar. So there's also the altar of God in your life. That altar has to be on fire. It has to be on fire. Forces of darkness want to quench the fire, but God says, no, my temple has to be on fire. My altar has to be on fire. Fire requires wood. Or let me say, generally, it requires fuel. Even the car requires fuel before it will move. You see that? So before the before you see the wood burning, it means that the wood is on fire. But the wood can burn out over time. Sometimes you see the wood burning out. When the wood becomes a burnt out wood, it becomes an ash. So in order to keep the fire burning, the woods are replaced. And not only that, very importantly, the ash or ashes have to be removed. So while you are replacing the woods, you also have to remove the ashes. There are things in our lives that we need to replace. There are also things in our lives we need to remove in order for the fire of God to keep burning. Now, in the old days, fire was carefully tended, and the fuel supplies were always closely monitored in order to make sure that the fire is on, is burning. Running out of fire could be deadly. In olden days, in the domestic setting, they use firewood to keep the house warm. And it has to be tendered. They have to be supplying woods. You have to have spare woods so that as the old ones are burning out, you replace them with new ones. And also, you also remove the ash. Running out of wood is deadly because it will lead to coldness. It's dangerous. People could die because of cold. Maybe while in deep sleep, they don't know that the fire had burnt out, and then you see cold everywhere. And that's how it is spiritually also. When our fire is not burning, or when it becomes burnt out, then we risk spiritual coldness. And it's dangerous. The enemy wants the fire to quench at all costs. The enemy wants the children of God to become burnt out woods. The enemy wants to see the children of God to become ashes. I don't need to remind you that there are many churches and ministries and the servants of God who used to be fire that have become ash, that have become cold. God himself wants us to be on fire. Jesus himself is fire. Hebrews 12 and 29 tells us our God is a consuming fire. Not just fire, but a consuming fire. The children of God also have to be consuming fire. Hebrews 1 verse 7, Psalm 104 verse 4 tells us also that God maketh his angels to be spirits and his ministers to be ministers of fire. And when God sees his people on fire, it gives him joy. It gives him joy. Several times when we're praying in this ministry, a lot of people tell me, oh, brother, while the prayer was hitting intensively, I saw Jesus smiling. I saw Jesus laughing. He said, that's my children. Because he was seeing what he wanted to see, what he wanted to see, and that is to see the fire of his love among his children. When I place you the fire of God, you see manifestations. You see the evidence that the Holy Spirit is at work. No wonder the church prays, send forth your spirit and enkindle in us the what? The fire of your love. Jesus. So God wants to see us on fire. He wants his people to be burning fire. Mother, friends in Christ, it is that fire that we have come to receive. It is that fire that we need, because we cannot afford to go through the year praying for people without having fire. You can only give what you have, mind you. You cannot give fire when you don't have fire. You cannot deliver people when you don't have fire. That reminds me of seven sons of Sceva. They loved the fire in Jesus. They loved the fire in Peter and Paul. They saw Peter casting out demons. They saw Paul casting out demons. They saw the manifestation of the fire, and they were happy about it. They were passionate about it, and they went into the business, but without being on fire. So when they saw someone who was demon possessed, and they said the name of Jesus Christ, whom Paul serves, I adjure you to come out. Before they could finish that sentence, that demon bounced on them. The Bible says that all of them were torn naked. They were beaten mercilessly, wounded. One person versus seven able-bodied men. You cannot cast demons without fire. It's not possible. So we need the fire to encircle us, to be in us, and to make us to be burning fire. This night is a night for someone to become a dangerous fire, electrocuting fire. There's a fire called electrocuting fire. Electrocuting fire is the type of fire that it will electrocute any evil that comes close. Jesus. The fire that if anything unclean comes close to burn them. The fire that they put Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego burnt the people that put Shadrach and Abednego into the fire. They were burnt. They were not in the fire, but they were burnt. That is serious fire. But that's a child's play compared with the fire that God is about to put in somebody this night.
Amen.
Now, whatever thing that is planning to come close, they're not even yet executing the action. They are just planning it. Before you know what is happening, vap! Because they have trespassed. Jesus. In our own modern time, technology has helped us so much. And so, we don't usually have a kind of a furnace in homes for heating homes. Even when you find them in modern houses, it's just merely for decoration, more or less. You know, because we have central heating system. So it's the wood for you see burning, some of them are merely artificially made stuff just to create an aesthetic impression. You know? So modern furnaces have taken the work out of keeping warm in cold climates. So today we just go and set the timer on the thermostat and the house will be warming. You get up in the morning, you enjoy the artificial climate you have created. But in ancient Israel, in ancient time, it was not so. You must need fire. Like I said earlier on, if the fire is not burning, if you run out of wood, if you run out of gas, you'll be stranded. Have you seen a car on the road not breaking down? Because there's no gas, it cannot move again. There are so many children of God. Most of them used to be prayer warriors who used to be on fire. But you see what? They're on the road. They are on the road as immobile vehicles. Vehicles that could not move again because they have run out of gas. I don't know if there's any of them here. But prayer is that Holy Ghost will put the gas in you tonight in the name of Jesus.
Amen. Amen.
Jesus. Or maybe your gas have run out and the house has become very cold. And life is threatened. People die because of cold anyway. I hope you know that. People can die spiritually because of spiritual coldness when the child of God runs out of fire. Running out of fire is dangerous. And so the altar of God has to be on fire. It is dangerous for the altar of God not to be on fire. And that was why God now told Moses to tell Aaron in Leviticus chapter 6, verse 8 to 13, that we read, that the priest has, or they have to, you know, let the fire be burning. They were instructed not to let the fire to go out. That we see in Leviticus chapter 6, verse 9. We'll see that in verse 12. We'll see that in verse 13. Three times, God warned, cautioned, instructed that the altar fire must be burning. This requires a lot of work. You have to go and gather some wood, you know, fetching or collecting firewood. You have to set them on fire. You have to be removing the ashes. Inasmuch as this is true physically, it is also true spiritually. We can become burnt out. We can burn out after long hours of fasting and prayers. We can burn out after long hours or days or months of intensive prayers. And that reminds me, few days ago, we concluded our 57-day fast and prayers that ended the year 2016. It was intensive fast and prayers, and then it was concluded with the marathon end of the year prayers that the intercessors conducted. And I want to use this opportunity to tell you that God will bless you for that wonderful and amazing marathon prayers. You stormed the heaven, and heaven answered you. May God bless you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
But you know what? It is possible that someone, that a prayer group, can become burnt out after a long time of serious prayers, and then they may start getting complacent. They may start getting weak. You know, their prayer life, may begin to diminish. A prayer group can be burnt out. Their spiritual fire could be burnt out, especially after intensive warfare that have been prolonged. During such warfare, you are hitting the covens of the devil, you are hitting the beehives, and the bees will come to sting. The bees will come to sting. Trying to sting weakness into you. Come to sting sickness into you. Trying to sting water in the house into you. Even problems in the offices. So that, as if to say, let me teach you a lesson. Next time, you try it again. There's not giving up. We are not giving up. We refuse to be intimidated. The people of fire, they do not fear the enemy. We are facing him according to James 4, verse 7, and as we resist him, he will flee. In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
When you strike the enemy, when you hit him with your dangerous prayer, with arrows of fire, they will not be happy. You know, it's a warfare, mind you. When the enemy comes to attack you back, strike you back, and see that you are intensively on fire, he will not joke with you again. He will just leave you. Even if he's coming again, he's planning at another different strategy. The Bible says, surely they will gather. But also, surely, children of God should also gather. In the name of
yes.
Jesus.
Amen.
So we have gathered to receive fire from the one who called us into this work, whose name himself is the consuming fire. We need that fire.
Oof.
I made a reference to the fire in the house that we use to keep the house warming. And we see that it's a process, really. Get the wood, gather the wood, you put it on fire, and you keep putting it in the ashes. Modern technology, like I said, has made it easier, and you just put the thermostat on, and the heater will start heating. And then just in a matter of minutes, you are feeling the warmth. The warmth of the car, you feel it. The warmth of the house, you feel it. But it's not so spiritually. There's no switch. You can just switch, bam, and you'll be 100 degrees Fahrenheit. No, it's a process. When you drop spiritually, you need a process to grow. It's not like, you know, putting on the modern finance. No. So now that we know the secret, we are here to ask our Lord Jesus to make us on fire again. To equip us with the fire. To decorate us with the fire. We remember that after Elijah confronted the prophets of Baal, in which he called on fire and fire came down, and they won the heart of Israel to back to God through that miracle. But you know what? He became burnt out. And he ran to the wilderness in frustration. The bees came to sting him. Jezebel wanted him dead or alive. Even paid people to go and get Elijah whatever place he was. When we get into serious warfare prayers, we don't expect anything less. We provoke the enemy, we provoke their kingdom, and they can send Jezebel to come and after us. But
wow.
They refuse to accept their plans in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Don't give up.
Hmm.
When Jezebel is sent after you, it is a sign you have done a good work. It is a sign that you have prayed the prayer that pleased God. And even when Jezebel is coming, and God allows Jezebel to come and attack you, God wants to make a way for you. Remember that? Jesus. Elijah was burnt out to the point that he prayed for death while in the wilderness. If he had the kind of spirit he had when he was praying for fire to come down, he wouldn't have prayed for death. But because he was burnt out, he didn't have any passion for life again. He didn't have any reason to keep living again. He hated everything about his ministry. He felt that, look, this doesn't worth it. All this prayer doesn't worth it. All this time of prayer and fasting doesn't worth it. Look, why has God abandoned me? Why has God allowed Jezebel and Ahab to fight me? Why all these things? All this time I have been praying and fasting. Why should it end up with a quarrel in the house? Why should it end up with sickness and headaches? Why should it end up with loss of job? Why?
Hmm.
Is that your question?
Mm-hmm.
I am here to give you a secret. God is preparing you for a greater height.
Amen.
In the name
Amen.
Of Jesus.
Amen.
Don't fear. I've always said it. If anybody should have fear attack, it is Borowakwe. But by God's grace, I have not attacked left, right, and center, front and back, to the point that I don't fear the devil again. When I started intercessory prayer first, the first day I preached, the devil came against me seriously. Then one day, I preached the second time, I went to meet people who were smoking what is called Indian hemp. marijuana also, marijuana, okay? I went to them, I preached the gospel to them. There were about 8 of them or so. But one gave his life right there, gave his life to Christ, life right there. Do you know that in the night, I saw all those boys, they came with gun. They said, you have taken one of our members to that man, and we have come to deal with you. We must kill you. And when they spread their bullets, none entered into my body. God will always protect you. Remember, they will always gather, but God will protect you. I even saw the boy that I led to Christ in that spirit. That boy was on my side. I saw myself, you know, beside him. I invited him to the fellowship. He joined us in the fellowship. Devil was not happy that he lost that soul. And I continued going out to the streets, preaching, going to public places, preaching. And one day I was sleeping in the depth of the night. I felt a chill on my body, a chill. Something so chilly. Oh my, I look at a black snake on me. I'm not talking of a dream. Life snake was on top of me. A snake sent to come and bite me while I was sleeping. But God closed the mouth of that snake. I was sleeping in a three-story building. How could a snake come to a three-story building? Who can answer that, please? But God shut them out. I want to tell you that even when you pray and be on fire and continue to do the work of God and continue to pray and never giving up and continue to be on fire, I tell you something. Even when the enemy comes with in evil, the Lord will shut their mouth.
Forever. Amen.
Amen.
If they put you on fire, the fire will not burn you. If they put you on water, you will not be drowned. Remember Isaiah chapter 43, verse 1 and 2. I call you by your names. Even when you are put in the fire, you will not be burnt. You will not be scorched. Even when you are put in the waters or rivers, you will not be drowned. That's not a joke. It's reality. It's a promise. And that's your heritage as a child of God.
Yes, God.
Jesus. Many of us think anointing is just like a switch. Switch it, bam, you'll be on fire. Look, it doesn't work that way. If it was that way, I would lay my hand on my little son, and if some night he will come to the prayer line and be helping me to make his prayers. It's a process. Sometimes it's like up and down, but you don't give up. You have to be consistent. You have to be focused. Elijah got to burnt out. It's a sign that there's no level you can get to the spirit. That frustration, the attack cannot come. The enemy will always come. Remember that they came against Jesus. Everything that happened to Jesus that would reflect in the station of the cross, that was a documentation of attack, series of attacks on Jesus.
Yes.
Even Elijah running to the wilderness and praying for death. You think he was making that prayer with normal eyes? It was because he was burnt out.
Yes.
He was burnt out. He was frustrated. There was a time I also got frustrated. I said, God, please, I'm done. Take my life. And he told me, son, go to Catholic prayer ministry. Lele. This happened years back ago when I was back home. And I went to Telele that afternoon. That was the Wednesday. Not even their usual pilgrimage time or week. When I came, there was mass going on. As I was stepping into the ministry, the minister, the pastor, the Reverend Father was ministering his homily, saying, things may be so difficult for you, and you say, God, take my life. I don't want to live again. God said, I should tell you today that you should be strong. I said, wow. This was what I just prayed for few minutes ago.
Mm-hmm.
God is watching, brother.
Mm-hmm.
After these prayers, after those prayers and fasting, you go to the house, your husband would that day will drink the highest alcohol. All this while I've been praying that God takes this bottle from him, but that day he starts seeing his own image in the bottle, talking to the bottle as if he's talking to a human being. He said, oh, after all these prayers, God, why have you allowed this to happen? This one has not happened before. I've been seeing him even drinking, but he has never gotten to the level of talking to the bottle. But now he's talking to the bottle. Don't give up! Even if you're talking to the bottle, keep praying. Don't give up. We are in a war field, mind you. We are in a war field. Elijah defeated the government of Baal single-handedly. Fought a great war. Won souls for Christ Jesus. Won souls for God. Turned the minds, the hearts of the people back to God. Single-handedly. What a great exploit. But at the end, he was burnt out. He was burnt out and he was praying for death. But that was the wrong prayer. God didn't answer that prayer. When you are praying for the wrong prayer, God will not answer you. He prayed for death. God, take my life. I'm no more better than my ancestors. God told my friend, what you need is food. Jesus. And God sent the best of the air to bring him food. God provided for him water. He ate and drank. And then he slept. You know, by sleeping, you get strength also. The strength that comes from sleeping. I hope you know that. He had all this, God gave him all these things as provisions. Even God woke him up after a long sleep. He said, continue eating. He ate again, ate, and he was very full. And now he was prepared for the journey of the year. He was prepared for a journey to the mountain of the Lord. In this night, we are going to receive the same experience. For somebody going to have spiritual rejuvenation, somebody going to experience spiritual strength, somebody going to experience spiritual food and water, so that you're able to have the strength, the vigor for the journey of the spiritual journey for the year.
Amen. Yes, Lord.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Jesus.
Jesus.
So while Elijah was praying for death, God said, no, my friend, what you need is spiritual strength, not death. Elijah was praying for the death of his ministry. Can you imagine the death of Elijah? That means the death of so many souls also. A lot of people will die because Elijah died. I mean spiritual death. His ministry was quenched, and those that God would have brought to himself through Elijah's ministry, their own life would have been quenched, spiritual life would have been quenched. So God said, look, let me tell you, my friend, I've not yet done with you. I still have a lot to achieve using you. And it was worse for Elijah anyway, because he was not connected to a prayer network. You know, Elijah prayed to God and said, Lord, I'm the only one left in Israel. Ahab and Jezebel had killed your other prophets. I'm the only one left. So in other words, he was alone. He was praying alone. There was no network. Even though God told him that, look, I have so many prophets who have not even eaten from the table of Ahab. They have not even contaminated themselves. But Elijah did not know that. He did not tap into that prayer network. If he knew, and those people gathered together to pray, as we have gathered together to pray this night, do you think Elijah would have been burnt out? Of course, no. There is power in corporate prayer. Corporate prayer is so powerful. One of the strategies of the devil to attack intercessors is to cut you off from corporate prayer. Anytime you think you can pray alone, you will die alone. Oh. You derive life, nourishment, vigor, strength by corporate anointing, corporate prayer. The minister of Elijah was in total danger because he wasn't tapping into corporate prayer. God has given us House of Jesus and Mary Ministry, intercessory community, a prayer network, fire. When you gather to pray, you see things happen. You're hearing the testimonies of people during the testimony night. People say, oh, I joined into the prayer of intercessors. Look at what happened during the marathon prayer. Testimonies. The power of corporate prayer. Corporate prayer brings corporate fire. Jesus. The danger of praying alone or fighting alone, I cannot talk enough about it this night. Let it not be our portion. In the name of Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
What Elijah needed was spiritual strength. He needed spiritual rejuvenation. Rejuvenation means renewal. It means resurgence, revitalization. It means revival. It means reawakening, recharging, new vitality. That's what it means. A new passion. It means being on fire. These are synonyms of spiritual rejuvenation. You have been fighting, praying for people throughout the year. Up till now, it's time for you to recoup, to rejuvenate. You know, even a tree, when a tree grows, and sometimes the parent tree will start getting tired, it starts growing a new one. It's time to grow a new leaf, brother. It's time to grow new leaf. For the journey. Growing new leaf means rejuvenation. Somebody who has been brown who is turning green tonight. In the name of Jesus. You see, when the tree, when you start seeing green, brown leaves on a tree, is a sign that the tree is drying up. That the leaf has no life again. It doesn't happen overnight. It's also a process. You start turning somehow yellowish, and then before you know what's happening, it's gone. That's how it is spiritually too. A child of God, when you see him turning yellowish, looking pale, looking sickly, spiritually, he doesn't come to prayers again. He starts giving excuses. He doesn't read the Bible again. Of course, having excuses before you know what's happening. At that point, is at the amber stage. Is at the somehow yellowish stage. It is a transition to the stop sign. At that stop sign, the devil stops you. Remember that even when you're driving on the road, the light is green. It remains green. When it doesn't go to red overnight, that is a transition. That's the amber light. Is there any person that is in the amber stage now? You cannot turn to red. You are going to turn to green in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
God is talking to us tonight.
Amen.
Jesus, can you imagine how many leaves that have fallen because they are brown? Can you imagine how many people of God that have fallen because they have turned brown? When you are brown, it means you are burnt out. When something is burnt out, it becomes brown. David cried when he heard about the death of Saul and Jonathan. He said, how the mighty fallen. Many mighty prayer warriors, many soldiers of Christ have turned brown. They are no more in the business of prayer. You talk to them about prayer, they say, look, I've done it those days, I think I'm done. There's no vacation in prayer. There's no vacation in this warfare. There's no vacation. No. Even at old age, you are supposed to be on fire. Jesus. So what we need now
after a year of long battle in prayer, praying for people, standing in the gap for them, is a spiritual rejuvenation. And so I'm giving this talk a title, Spiritual Rejuvenation. Spiritual Rejuvenation. Jesus. God does not like his people to be cold. He doesn't even want his people to be somehow cold. Otherwise called lukewarmness. He doesn't even want that. Remember he said in Revelation chapter 3, the Bible says, I know your works. You are neither hot nor cold. How I wish you are either one. Because you are lukewarm, I vomit you out of my mouth. So God said, I vomit lukewarmness. Those who are lukewarm, they need rejuvenation.
Mm-hmm.
Those who are cold, they need rejuvenation.
Mm-hmm.
And this was what God was telling his prophet, Moses, to tell Aaron to put and to make sure that the fire is burning at the altar. Leviticus chapter 6, verse 9, 12, and 13 tells us that we are to keep the spiritual fire burning by supplying more spiritual wood and removing every ash. And tonight, such ashes covering our fire shall be removed in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Spiritual passion is not something to be treated lightly or taken for granted. You know, it will grow cold if we fail to keep it supplied with gas or wood. Apostle Paul addressed the subject of spiritual, rejuvenation in his letter to the Romans, in Romans chapter 12, verse 1 to 2, and verse 11. He told them to keep the fire of their devotion burning strong. And to do that, he told them that they must continue to work hard in prayer. He told them that they must continue the hard work of stocking their woods of hope, of patience, of steadfast prayer, of generosity, of hospitality, and humility. This you'll find in Romans 12, verse 16 to 11 to 16. You know, just as a candle cannot burn without fire, so intercessors, prayer warriors, cannot operate effectively without fire. You need the fire of the rejuvenating fire of the Holy Spirit.
Mm.
And yet, sometimes, we let that spiritual candle burn out. In order to keep it lit with fire, we need to renew ourselves spiritually. If I may ask you, do you want to receive a new breath of the Holy Spirit tonight? Do you want God to breathe a new vitality into your life, into your spiritual life?
Yes.
At this point in time, we are warming up to get into prayers. Father, Lord, I thank you for this message you have given. Thank you for preparing us with your word, to prepare us on this platform for the great things you are about to do this year using your intercessors. Father, thank you for these ones you have given to me to gather and pray for your people, to join me in praying for your people. And Father, I pray for them that it shall be well with them this year in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
My dear friends in Christ, we are getting into a time of prayer. And I want to take you back to the experience of Elijah. When Elijah was burnt out, God sent the bear to bring him food. God provided water. God gave him sleep. My dear friends in Christ, he then received the food, the water, and the sleep, and had the strength to journey to the mountain of the Lord. We have a long journey ahead of us. This is just the beginning of the year. The year is still at infant stage. We need spiritual food, spiritual water, and the sleep, strength, in order to have the vitality to go through the year in this spiritual journey. My dear friends in Christ, Elijah experienced the power of God and he had the strength. The next person is you.
Yeah.
It's time to be spiritually rejuvenated. Jesus. And so we are going to pray that even as we have gone through years and years of prayers, a complete year of fasting and praying for people, may God at this hour rejuvenate us in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
When people are weak, when they go to the hospital, they'll be given vitamins to make them strong. I'm praying tonight, and I invite you in this prayer for God to give us spiritual vitamins in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
There are vitamins you need to build your spiritual immunity. You see, even physically, but vitamins are even, you know, needed to build immunity, your immunity, so that when attack comes, you will be able to, you know, your body will be able to stand against being corrupted or being attacked. If your immunity is so weak, you cannot do anything. The enemy will just come, the germ or the bacteria will just come and have its way. I am praying for you this night that God will give you the spiritual vitamin you need this year as you get into prayers in the name of Jesus. Jesus. You need that vitamin. Ask him to give you that vitamin. Talk to him to reach you with that spiritual vitamin. Let him give you that vitamin of grace. Let him give you that vitamin. You need it to stay spiritually alert, spiritually healthy. Any man, any person whose life is lacking vitamin cannot be strong. He cannot be healthy. Talk to God now. Ask him to inject into your life spiritual vitamins. Ask him to inject into your life the spiritual vitamins. You need that now in the name of Jesus. Ask him to give you the spiritual vitamins to boost your appetite for God, to boost your appetite for the word of God, to boost your appetite for prayer, your appetite for fasting. Begin to talk to God now. Yes, my Lord. Ask him to infuse into your blood the spiritual vitamins to produce hunger and thirst for God. In the name of Jesus, ask him to fill you with spiritual vitamins. You need a vitamin now. Yes, my Lord, fill my people with the spiritual vitamins in the name of Jesus. May my people not be vulnerable again. May God give you the spiritual vitamin in the name of Jesus. There are vitamins that are necessary for vision. If you have eye problem, you go to a doctor, they will recommend the appropriate vitamins so that you can be seen well. I am praying that those that have lost their power of visions, may God give you the spiritual vitamins tonight so that you will be seeing clearly like the eagle in the name of Jesus. I was watching National Geographic Channel some years ago, and I saw an eagle. This eagle was far away, but it moved. The way it moved, I suspected that it saw something. This eagle flew very long distance, miles, and ended up striking a portion of the of a river, and behold, look at a fish on the leg. It grabbed a fish and took it into the air. My wife asked me, does it mean that this ego saw this fish from this distance, from that long distance of over 2 miles? I told her that's what it means. Then the person who was narrating the documentary said that the ego, they have powerful eyes, they could see over 2 miles, 3 miles, sometimes even 5 miles away. So that means this ego was able to see the prey at that distance. When you have the eye of the ego, it means you will see far in the spirit. I don't know whether your spiritual retina is sick. I don't know what is, maybe your spiritual iris is very, very weak. I am praying for healing at this hour. I am praying for healing at this hour. That those that have the gift of vision, may you receive that spiritual vitamin at this hour. May you begin to see clearly things that God wants to reveal to his people. May that gift be better manifest. May your eyes begin to manifest in the name of Jesus. May your eyes be activated so that you begin to see clearly in the name of Jesus. I am praying that anointing oil be poured on you in the spiritual realm, that everything that has covered your eyes will begin to fall out. Let that very plank, let that thing that have covered your eyes, let them begin to fall out right now. May Holy Spirit begin to touch your eyes so that you begin to see clearly. May God give you that vitamin that you may begin to see clearly in the name of Jesus. I am praying also for those who have the gift of hearing the voice of God. May you begin to hear that voice clearly this year in the name of Jesus. I am praying that you hear him and hear him clearly. I am also praying that you will not see any demonic vision, that God will tune you to the right frequency, that God will tune you to the right frequency of the Spirit in the name of Jesus. Tuning to the right frequency is very important. In those days, old television, you tune them. And when you are getting close to the right channel of interest, you start seeing it clearer. But you start also seeing other pictures that are not even from that channel. That's interference. Interference. The process of removing interference signals is called, you know, tuning. You tune your radio. When your radio is clear, it means you are right on that frequency. But when you are hearing some other noise, other signals, you are receiving them, you are in, for example, 96.1 megahertz frequency, but you are hearing other signals that are coming from 95.7 megahertz frequency. Other signals are coming in. Maybe there are 10 stations, you are hearing them at the same time. It happens. Interference. But when you are rightly tuned, you don't hear another voice. My prayer for you this year, even now, is that God Almighty will tune your spiritual hearing, your spiritual antenna, your spiritual eyes to the right frequency, so that what you see will be unadulterated signals, will be signals that can never be interfered, that any interfering signal from the demonic kingdom will never get into your life, because you are properly tuned to Jesus' frequency. I am tuning you now through the prayer in the spiritual realm. May my people be tuned to JESUS megahertz in the name of Jesus. May you be tuned to that spiritual frequency of Jesus. I am tuning you now through the prayer that you will see the right visions, that in this year you will hear the right voice in the name of Jesus. You see, let me even tell you something. The reason why the enemy brings his own vision is to cause confusion. It's an attack. And even in the physical realm, one of the ways you can attack your enemy is to interfere with the signals. You interfere with the signals. So, for example, if a nation A is at war with the nation B, and if a nation B finds out the frequency of the nation A, you know what they will do? They will send a signal, interfering signals that hovers around their own frequency, and they bring in interfering voice. So when A says, go to bomb position A, position in the territory of B, this person who is supposed to bomb will go and bomb by the wrong place because of interference. When the enemy sees that you are praying and your prayer is doing great exploits, what they want to do is to interfere. So many prayer groups have been interfered seriously. Many of them are victims of interference. When visions are interfered with, it causes confusions, incoherence. You know, people get confused. You don't know who to believe again. A is giving prophecy, go and marry that man. The other one is saying, that one is a witchcraft spirit. Another one is saying, he's an occult. Another one is saying, that's the man of God. Confusion everywhere. God is not, the hand of God is not that confusion. Our God is not the author of confusion. I am praying this day, standing before the altar of God, that God may tune you to the right frequency that can never be deciphered by the enemy.
Amen.
So that when you see visions, they will be on the point. When you give prophecies, they shall be on the point. Go and read Jeremiah chapter 38, verse 1 to 13. You see that there were false prophets that were giving negative prophecies, but God sent Jeremiah and gave him the right frequency. May that anointing of Jeremiah be upon you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
May that anointing for right prayer, for right signals be upon you. I am covering this platform of prayer with the blood of Jesus. I cover the blood of Jesus so that when you gather in this platform to pray, things will happen. Interfering spirits will not come close in the name of Jesus. Have you asked yourself why sometimes you see people putting their antenna in on top of the building? Some tall buildings, you see some antennas there. It's for better reception. Better reception of signals. And because you are in the spiritual upper room, you shall also receive pure, unadulterated signals in the name of Jesus. The prayer line is our upper room. So while people of the world, they go to tall mountains to build their towers, communication towers, or go to tall buildings and build their, or install their antennas and communication towers, so also, by being in our own ministry, in this platform, we have come to our own upper room. And so we shall receive the right signals in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
And so I yield the opportunity to bind every spirit of false message, false prophecies, false visions and voice. I stand against them. And I command them to burn into pieces. And I minister the blood of Jesus upon your eyes, upon your ears, upon your tongues, upon your body, in the name of the Father and Son, the Holy Spirit, in Jesus' name. Jesus. Elijah also received the food, and he drank the water. And with that, he was able to make the journey. I am praying for you at this hour, in the course of the year, even now. May God give you his body as food to eat and be strong and be healthy spiritually in the name of Jesus. May he give you his blood to drink as a drink for your spiritual rejuvenation in the name of Jesus. As you receive that blood and body, may it be well with you. May that God who sent the bear to bring food and water for the prophet, may that same God give you his own food and blood this night that you need for the journey of the year. May he send his angels to feed you tonight in the name of Jesus. And any power of the devil that wants to come in the night season to feed you in the dream with evil food and water, may this Jesus blood, body and blood, paralyze and close the doors of such demonic interference in your life in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Every spiritual cataract that is preparing food for you, I cancel in the name of Jesus. I seal your mouth to the spirit that it must not open to eat demonic foods in the name of Jesus. Sometimes when a child of God is growing the spirit, the enemy goes in the spirit to give them spiritual food, demonic foods, to weaken them. May that not be your portion this year in the name of Jesus. May that not be your portion this year in the name of Jesus. When Elijah got to the mountain of the Lord, a strong wind, something like a hurricane-like wind came. But God was not there. God was in the wind. He wasn't there in the hurricane. Earthquake came also, but God was not there. Fire came, but God was not there. But God sent a gentle breeze. And there, God was there. I am praying for you at this moment in prayer. May God send the wind of his presence, the wind of the upper room that came down, ushering the new thing God wanted to use the disciples of the old to do. May he usher that wind of revival upon every intercessor hearing my voice now. May you receive that wind now, that wind of revival. May that wind blow on you. May that wind blow on you and fill with the fire and empower you in the name of Jesus. Now, remember in Leviticus chapter 6, verse 8 to 13 that we read, that God told Moses to tell Aaron, you must remove the ash. You must remove the ash from the altar. Ash quenches fire. There are two ways you can remove the ash. You can decide to scoop it and throw them away, or you can blow a wind. You can send a wind. You can set a fan, a strong wind from a fan, to blow them away. And so because Elijah experienced the wind, the strong wind, and the mountain of the Lord, and even now we are in our own mountain of the Lord, may that wind blow now and blow out of our lives every ash covering our fire in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
What is the ash covering your fire? Is that pride? Is that unforgiveness? What is it? Is that holding on to the past? The heart failures? Past failures? I don't know what is the ash covering your fire. But what I know is that you cannot carry it into the air. It is time for the ash to be removed. God told Moses to tell Aaron that that ash must be removed so that the fire will burn. And I'm praying for somebody at this hour. May that ash in your life be removed. I provoke a wind, the Holy Ghost wind. May that wind, the wind of the Holy Ghost, begin to blow upon you now and blow out of your life every ash hanging on your life, every ash covering your fire. May they be blown out now. May they be blown out now in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Yes, my Lord. Talk to God now. Talk to God now. Every ash covering my fire. Every ash covering my fire. Let them be removed. Let them be removed. Open your mouth and pray now. Every ash covering my fire. Let them be removed. Let them be removed. Yes, my Lord. Jesus. Jesus. Pray now, pray now. The Bible says in Leviticus chapter 6, verse 10b, that ash of the burnt offering has to be removed. Let that ash be removed right now. Open your mouth and pray. Every ash covering my life, covering my fire, covering my anointing, covering my prayer life. Let that as removed. Let that as removed. Prayer, 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 prayer. Jesus. Jesus. Pray, my people, pray, my people. Let that as removed. Pray now, pray now, pray now. Don't give that ash opportunity to live in a life. Don't leave that ash on your shoulders. Don't leave that ash on your life. That ash must disappear tonight. Pray now, pray now, pray now, pray now. Jesus. Pray, my people, pray, my people. Let the ash removed. Let the ash removed. In the name of Jesus. 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 Yes, yes, yes. Pray now, pray now. Every ash of my life, every ash covering my glory, every ash of shame, let them remove, let them remove. Isaiah chapter 61 says, and let the ash shall be removed. Yes, pray now, pray now. Jesus, pray my people, let the ash be removed. The ash of shame, the ash of shame, let the ash be removed. In the name of Jesus, pray now, pray now, pray now. Jesus, Jesus, pray my people, pray my people. This is your year of favor, not a year of ashes, not a year of shame. Pray now, pray now, pray now. Yes, my Lord. The Bible says, Isaiah chapter 61, verse 3, and I will comfort them that mourn and provide for them who grieve in Zion to bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes. And oil of joy instead of ashes. Pray now, pray now, pray now. Jesus, yes, my Lord, let my ash be removed. Every ash of my life, I command you to move now. In the name of Jesus, open your mouth and pray now. Call on Jesus. Begin to call on him now. Let the ash be removed. In the name of Jesus, every ash of my life, I command you now. In the name of Jesus. Burn out, burn out, burn out. Let them be disappeared. Let them disappear right now. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus. Jesus. In the name of Jesus.
Jesus.
Jesus. Oh! After the ash is removed, something needs to replace it. Something needs to replace the ash. The Bible tells us in Leviticus chapter 6, verse 10, then the priest shall wear a linen robe and a linen shorts. I don't know what you are wearing. Maybe you have been wearing the ash, the garment of ash, the robe of ash. But God is saying, it's now time to wear the robe of righteousness, the robe of fire, the robe of prayer in the name of Jesus. The reason why that ash has been on you is to quench the fire of prayer. But now that the ash is removed, you need to wear the garment of fire, the garment of prayer. Open your mouth and pray now. Ask God to wear the garment of fire. Ask him to wear the garment of prayer in the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord and my fire, my Lord and my Father, wear me the garment of fire. Wear me the garment of fire. Now that you remove the garment of ashes, wear me the garment of fire, the garment of righteousness, the garment of prayer. I wear it now. I wear it now. I wear it as undergarment. I wear it now in the name of Jesus. I wear it as a cloth on my body, as an apparel in the name of Jesus. The garment of fire is upon me now in the name of Jesus. Jesus. Also, when Elijah was on that mountain, the mountain of the Lord, he saw an earthquake. He experienced the earthquake. The mountain was shaking. Everywhere shaking. In fact, he thought that the mountain would collapse on him. But the Lord was not there. When the earth was shaking, when the mountain was shaking, Elijah saw the rocks falling down. The rocks. You see that? When the mountain is shaking, you see rocks falling down. Those days, as a little boy, Sometimes I find it very difficult to climb it during tree. So what I usually do is to shake the branch of that orange, and the fruits, the oranges will fall on their own. Many of them will fall. That earthquake in your life need to make something to fall out of your life. There is something in you that need to drop this night. You don't need to carry it into the air. As a prayer warrior, you don't need to carry it. It had to be shaken off. It had to be shaken off. It has to drop this night.
In the name of Jesus.
The earthquake was quaking, and the rocks were falling. What is the rock in your life that need to fall? What is that thing that is dropping your prayer life? That thing has to be dropped this night. It has to fall.
In the name of Jesus.
Elijah is telling us that God wants to use us to pull down the rocks of the enemies in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
God has given us the anointing to pull down the fortresses, the powers of the enemy, whatever place they are, whatever thing that is hanging on your life, that is making you not to be prayerful the way you're supposed to be. Tonight, God is going to pull them down in the name of Jesus.
Put them and put in their
yes, my Lord.
In the name of Jesus.
Jesus, whatever it is in your life that need to drop this night, whatever that need to be to drop, talk to God about it. Talk to God about it. Whatever thing that is hanging on your life, I don't know what it is, but that thing has to drop. That thing has to drop. It has to drop. Yes, my Lord, it has to drop in the name of Jesus. It has to drop. Command them to drop. Command them to drop in the name of Jesus. God has empowered us that those things shall not follow us into the air. I reject that thing that is hanging on my life, that it must drop tonight. Let the spiritual earthquake drop it as the earth is quaking. Through this prayer, we are provoking earthquake. Through this prayer, we are provoking spiritual shaking, spiritual quake in our lives, and let all such situations begin to be quaked out of our lives. Let them begin to drop out of our lives right now in the name of Jesus. Now, let me tell you something. There were things hanging on the life of the prophet Jeremiah. Things that were not planted by the Lord were hanging on his life. You see that? One of them was fear. God sent him to go and minister to the people, but he was giving excuses. He was wondering, how would I be able to do this? And he was afraid, how would I be able to talk to the king? The same thing with Moses. In fact, Moses was giving excuses, telling God, I'm a Samaritan. Even Aaron is a better public speaker. God said, but I have called you. As a Jeremiah, just like most of us, wonder, this thing that's hanging on me, I can't be able to do it. I can't be able to do this work of God. But God says to Jeremiah in Jeremiah 1 verse 4, that the word of God came to me saying, verse 5, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I set you apart. I made you an intercessor. I appointed you as a prophet to the nations. This was what Jeremiah didn't know. Jeremiah said in Jeremiah 1 verse 6, oh Lord, I do not even know how to speak. I am too young. He was giving excuses. Too young is even different from not knowing how to speak. But Lord told him in Jeremiah chapter 1 verse 7, do not say, I am too young. You must go to everyone I send you to and say whatever I command you. So do not be afraid of them, for I am with you, and I will rescue you. And so Jeremiah was bold. He went into the ministry as an intercessor, as a prophet. He went to the people and was preaching. Even though they put him in prison, in chapter 38, they put him in the pit. But the Lord delivered him. And so shall the Lord also deliver you. For any problem the devil will package against you, because you are an intercessor. May the God of Jeremiah also deliver you in the name of Jesus. Jesus. My dear friends in Christ, the Lord had to remind Jeremiah in Jeremiah chapter 1 verse 10, telling him, see, today I appointed you over nations, over kingdoms, to uproot, to tear down, to destroy, to overthrow, to build, and to plant. This is what intercessors do. To uproot, to tear down, to destroy, to overthrow, to build, and to plant. As I'm praying at this hour, that the anointing that will make your prayers to become instruments to uproot and tear down, let it begin to come on you now. Anointing that will make your prayers to become volcanic, to become like a bulldozer, that will tear down, that will uproot, that will destroy, that will overthrow, that will destroy the power of the devil. May such anointing come on you in the name of Jesus. Jesus. I pray that your prayers will build and plant. I pray that your prayer shall cause earthquake in the kingdom of darkness this year. In the name of Jesus. I pray that as we are praying, things that are not supposed to be in this message will drop out. They will drop down on their own accord. When the earthquake is taking place, things fall down. Something needs to shake because something needs to fall down. I pray that whatever that's on you or in you that is hanging in your life, may they be shaken off, may they fall down, may they fall down, may they fall down, may they be shaken down in the name of Jesus. I pray that sicknesses, fibroid, cancers that are hanging on people, as you pray for them, may they shake and fall. May those things fall down. The Bible says in Haggai chapter 2, verse 6, in a little while, I will once more shake the heavens and the earth and the sea and the dry land. I will shake all the nations, and what is desired by all the nations will come, and I will fill this house with glory. The latter rain will be greater than the former rain. So I pray for you, according to Haggai chapter 2, verse 6, 7, and following, that the Almighty God will make you a house of prayer, a house of glory, a house of anointing, in the name of Jesus, that whenever you are praying, there will be spiritual earthquakes taking place, making sickness to drop out of people, making the works of the devil, the fruits of the devil, to drop out of people, drop out of the ministry on their own accord in the name of Jesus. The Bible says, in a little while, I will shake the heavens, earth, the sea, and the dry land, and every nations. Who will hear you to shake them? HJM Ministry Intercessors. He's using you, he's using the ministry to shake heavens, to shake the earth, to shake the sea, to shake the dry land. People that enemies are holding their children, as you pray, the hand of the devil will release the children, because the shaking will be so intensive that the children will drop out of the hand of the enemy into the womb of our women. In the name of Jesus. But somebody has to pray a prayer that will shake. It has to be you. Jeremiah did it, and God answered him. Jesus. People that their job envelopes are in the hands of the devil, as you pray, I tell you, the hand of the devil will break, and that envelope will slip out of their hands into the hands of the children of God. Great things shall happen this year. I am praying that your prayer will cause volcanic eruption, even earthquake in the sea, in the dry land, everywhere in the world. Even ICs, because of this prayer, will repent this year in the name of Jesus. prayer warriors. May God bless you. May God use your prayers to shake the nations. May He use the prayers to shake everywhere so that the desire of God will come on earth in the name of Jesus, so that you be filled with the house of fire and glory. May you be filled with that glory in the name of Jesus. And as if Elijah needed more, God sent a gentle breeze. A gentle breeze. God was in that breeze. God was in that breeze. But before God sent that breeze, Elijah also experienced fire. And God was not in the fire. Every fire that is ravaging the life of people, ravaging ministries, ravaging governments, I pray against such a fire through your prayer, through the anointing of God in your life, through the prayer of intercessors. May such fire of the enemies be quenched in the name of Jesus. May the fire of Jesus swallow the fire of the enemies, just like the rod of Moses turning to snakes swallowed the snakes of Pharaoh. So shall your fire swallow the fire of the enemies in the name of Jesus. People that their houses are burning on fire spiritually, may your prayers quench the fire. Jesus. Every fire the devil is bringing to your life, may God quench that fire in the name of Jesus. Jesus. And after the fire, Elijah experienced a gentle breeze. Gentle breeze. And God was in that breeze. Let me tell you something about breeze. You see, when the fire is burning, wildfire, it is a gentle breeze that causes it to burn more. The gentle breeze causes the fire to burn more. Have you asked yourself why, when you want fire to burn more, you start puffing air? You know why you do that? You are sending breeze to enkindle the fire, to make the fire to burn more. Sometimes people get a fan and start to fan the fire. Oh, that reminds me. In 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 6, Paul wrote to Timothy and told Peter, remember the gift you received when I laid my hands on you. Fan it into flame. Fan, F-A-N. Fan it into flame. So that means you fan fire to flame. You fan your spiritual gift to flame. That's what it means. And so the gentle breeze is going to quicken the fire of God in our lives this night. It's going to quicken the fire of God in our lives. We need that fire, that gentle breeze, to begin to blow on us now. And so in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom I serve, I minister the gentle breeze on you now. Let the gentle breeze begin to blow. Let the spiritual fan begin to be activated now, so that you begin to be fanned to flame. In the name of Jesus, receive that gentle breeze and be fanned to flame. Let your anointing be fanned to flame. In the name of Jesus, let your tongue be fanned to flame. Let your spiritual gift be fanned to flame. Everything about your life, may all of them begin to bring glory to God, and let all them be fanned to flame in the name of Jesus. Elijah saw the power of God. He saw the finger of God, the hand of God. When the gentle breeze was blowing, may you receive it now. In the name of Jesus, this is your time, your turn to receive the gentle breeze. Get ready now to receive the gentle breeze. In the name of Jesus, get ready to receive the gentle breeze. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus. Jesus. Pray now, pray now, pray now. Yes, my Lord. Let the power of gentle breeze come upon you now. Somebody receive the gentle breeze now. Somebody receive the gentle breeze now. Receive Receive the gentle breeze now. Receive the gentle breeze now. As the gentle breeze is blowing now, be quick in the now. Aha! Be quick in the now. Be quick in now. The gentle breeze for powerful prayer life. Let that little light become a confire in you. Let that little fire in you begin to breathe into flame. Let it turn into flame. Let it become fire of flame in the name of Jesus. And so at this hour, I am calling on God to send the Holy Ghost fire to come down on you. The mighty fire. Let that fire come on you. The fire of the Pentecost. This is a time of fire. This is a time of renewal. Receive the fire now. The breath of God is coming on you now. The breath of the Holy Ghost is coming on you now. Oh, yeah, receive it now. Oh, yeah, receive it now. I can feel the power. I can feel the power. The power is moving now. Ay, 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 ay. The power of God is moving now. The anointing for new vitality is coming upon you now. God is raising his breath. Holy Ghost is raising his breath. A new fire now. Let that fire come on you. Let that fire come on you. Receive the fire now. Receive the fire now. A fire for new charging. A fire for recharging. A fire for reawakening. A fire for revival. For revitalization. For rejuvenation. For resurgence. For spiritual stimulation. Somebody is being stimulated now through this prayer now, through this fire. Let the fire stimulate you in the name of Jesus. My people receive it now. O machine de bobo, maso konde ya baba, masinde ya bo kondorobo. The power of God is moving now. The power of God is moving now. Sweet fire is moving now. Hugo fire is moving now. Catch the fire, catch the fire, catch the fire. The fire for new exploits. The fire for new exploits. Let your spiritual gifts be made manifest now. Let your spiritual gifts. Ah, be made manifest now. Receive it now. Receive it now. Anointing for the Ghost. Anointing for the Ghost. Receive it, anointing. Receive it. Receive it. Receive it. Power. Ay, 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 ay. Ye, ba, 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 sinde, ya, bo. Rende, bo, 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 bo. The power of God is moving now. Yes, my Lord. It's us. Receive the fire. Receive the fire. The burning fire. The burning fire, the burning fire, the burning fire, the burning fire. Let my people, let them catch fire. My people, catch the fire now. Catch the fire now. Catch the fire now. Are you receiving it? Yeah, oh, 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 oh. Yes, my Lord. Ay, 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 ay. The fire is the burning. Receive the burning fire. Receive the burning fire. Receive the burning fire. The Eucharist fire. The mighty fire, the mighty fire, the mighty fire, the mighty fire. Cut it now, cut it now, cut it now. Receive it, receive it. In the name of Jesus. Oh, oh, machine there, Bobo. I am soaking you with the blood of Jesus. I soak every one of you with the blood of Jesus. I seal your prayers for the year, brother of Jesus. All the prayers you will do in the months of the year, in the weeks of the year, I declare all of them fertile and productive in the name of Jesus. I soak you with the blood of Jesus. May God who has rejuvenated you keep you rejuvenated. May you remain on fire. May you remain on fire. May your fire never burn out. May your wood never go dry. Any water that wants to quench your fire, may God destroy that fire. That water, I'm destroyed in the name of Jesus. I am blessing you, and I soak you, blood of Jesus. I bo shinderaba. Let the blood of Jesus surround you. Let the blood of Jesus be with you. May God be with you. I cover your anointing, blood of Jesus. Anywhere you are now, lift up your right hand. Father, as your people have lifted up their hands, I impart anointing upon them. We hold our hands together in the spirit, and we connect our hands in a circle, and let those circles terminate in the hands of Jesus. As we hold our hands with Jesus in the spiritual realm, let the anointing, the intercessory anointing from Jesus, begin to flow from hand to hand now. Let it flow like a little current from hand to hand through every intercessor, even intercessors that are yet to join or to be commissioned. May they be located spiritually and be connected. Whoever that is meant to be part of you this year, I pray that they must be connected to you. Whoever is not meant to be with you, that are with you, may they drop out. And those who are supposed to be with you, that are not here with you, may they be connected. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. I connect you to Hebrews 7, verse 25, where the Bible says, therefore, he is able to save completely. May he save you completely, whose name is Jesus. May he save you completely. The Bible says that he always lives to intercede for you, for us. May that intercessor whom we are connected to be the center of our anointing. May he continue to renew us as he is, and as we are connected to him, may we continue to be with him and be like him. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen and amen and amen. You may bring down your hands. Thank you, Jesus. I cover this prayer tonight, brother of Jesus. And Father, we thank you for everything you have done tonight. We give you all the glory. Blessed be your name. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, El Shaddai. I cover the intercessor, brother of Jesus. I cover the brother of Jesus. I cover their ways, brother of Jesus. I cover their going out and coming in, brother of Jesus. I pray that this year, great things shall happen. I pray that this year, they will go to places. Father, thank you. Amen. Blessed be your name. Jesus, amen. I cover you once more with the blood of Jesus. I cover you, blood of Jesus. May God bless you. Bless your family. Bless the works of your hand. Bless your tongues, amen, that it may be tongues of fire. In the name, amen, of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, we pray with thanksgiving. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.